Enthusiasts of Holy Adventist Church, a revival of ancient biblical Christianity and original Adventism presents Escape for Thy Life, a program of Bible prophecy. Pioneer history, natural disasters, theological topics, health reform, conspiracies, comparative religion, rights and freedoms, and creation versus evolution. Escape for Thy Life.
This is Brother Medina for Tuesday Seventh-day Adventist Church, and please let us start with a word of prayer. Loving Father, please be with us as we present these facts in this our inaugural program. Bless all our listeners. Let them understand and let them see the truth of the matter as the end draws near. In Jesus' holy name we pray with thanksgiving unto you. Amen. Well, this is the very first of a series of television programs that Tuesday Seventh-day Adventist Church is now having. And we will be on every fortnightly on this television station. The first program, the very first, obviously, we should show you who or what is Tuesday Seventh-day Adventist. And the name of this program, Escape for Thy Life, we have to show you why that name, Escape for Thy Life. And this is what our program is going to be all about. We are going to talk about who or what is Tuesday Seventh-day Adventist, and we are also going to be discussing the nature of the program, Escape for Thy Life. Now, first of all, you hear Tuesday Seventh-day Adventist. And in Tuesday Seventh-day Adventist, we have a particular meaning of this church as to why this church exists. Tuesday Seventh-day Adventist exists in Trinidad and Tobago, in Grenada, in St. Vincent, in Pakistan, in Canada, and the United States of America, with also members in various parts of the earth. It started in Trinidad and Tobago and spread all abroad to different countries. But we want you to know why and why do we exist. We must let you know also that we are not affiliated with the South Caribbean Conference of Seventh-day Adventists. We are an independent Seventh-day Adventist church. This is a revival of apostolic Christianity and ancient Adventism from the 1840s. And this is the reason why we are going to explain to you about Tuesday Seventh-day Adventist. Now, the word Tuesday is a Greek word, and it means self-sacrifice because of Christ's sacrifice. Self-sacrifice because of Christ's sacrifice. The word seventh day points to which day is the Sabbath of Yahweh, thy God. And the word Adventist means a preparatory looking for the second visible coming of Jesus Christ. So, in other words, Tuesday, Seventh-day Adventist. Now, first of all, we need to take a look at what the word seventh day means in Seventh-day Adventist. And afterwards, we will talk about what the word Tuesday means. If we turn our Bibles to Genesis chapter 2, and we look at these verses, verse 1 to verse 3, here is exactly what we are told. I quote, it says this, Genesis chapter 2, 1 to 3, it tells us this, thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the hosts of them, and on the seventh day, God ended his work which he had made, and rested on the seventh day from all the work which he had made. And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because that in it he had rested from all his work which God created and made. So the very first thing we see here is that the seventh day is brought into focus at the very beginning of creation, because God rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had made. So by saying seventh day, you are pointing to the day that is the seventh day Sabbath. Yes, my dear people. Furthermore, if you look at Exodus chapter 20, and we look at from verses 8 to verse 11, here is what we are told. I quote, "Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of Yahweh thy God." So while evangelicals and the Catholics and other churches have the first day as their Sabbath, the Sabbath of Yahweh thy God, we are told, is the seventh day. And this scripture here points to the Sabbath being the seventh day. So if you ask, which day is the Sabbath? The Bible answers, the seventh day is the Sabbath. Yes, my dear people. Now, furthermore, if we turn to Hebrews chapter 4, Hebrews chapter 4 explains to us a certain important issue with regards to the seventh day Sabbath. Yes, my dear people. In Hebrews chapter 4, if we look at verse 9, if we look at verse 3 to verse 5, and then we will go to verse 9 and then verse 10, but verse 3 to verse 5 clearly tells us that all those who believe do enter into the Lord's rest. Now, what is this Lord's rest? Usually, evangelical tells us that it is rest from sin. So that if you enter into the Lord's rest, you enter into rest from sin. That's what they tell us. But here is what the Bible tells us about the Lord's rest. In Hebrews chapter 4, and we're looking at verses 3 to verse 5. Here is what it tells us. I quote, "For we which have believed do enter into rest." Did you get that? So when a person believes, they enter into rest, although the works were finished from the foundation of the world. Now, why is that said, although the works were finished from the foundation of the world? It says this because, I continue reading, "For he spake in a certain place of the seventh day on this wise, and God did rest the seventh day from all his works. And in this place again, if they shall enter into my rest." So what do we see here clearly? That God's rest, the Lord's rest, is identified as the seventh day. Now this is what Hebrews chapter 4 tells us. We didn't make it up. Hebrews chapter 4 tells us, "For he spake in a certain place of the seventh day, and God did rest the seventh day from all his works." So we are clearly being told here in this scripture, the seventh day is the day that God rested, and that is the Lord's rest. And we who believe do enter into that rest. Yes, my dear people, this is what we are being told. Furthermore, if we go to verse 9 and verse 10, here is what we are told. I quote, "There remaineth therefore a rest to the people of God. For he that entered into his rest, he also had ceased from his own works, as God did from his." This is what we are being told here. Now, the point about the matter is this. It is plain and simple. We are told there remaineth therefore a rest for the people of God. But the surprising thing about it here is that the word rest here is translated from the Greek word sabbatismos. Yes, my dear people, sabbatismos. What does this Greek word sabbatismos mean? I quote for you from Thayer's lexicon. Thayer's lexicon. Here is what we are told. It tells us this. Sabbatismos, keeping Sabbath. Sabbatismos, keeping Sabbath. And then again, we quote the Complete Word Study Dictionary New Testament by Spyros Zohadiatis, page 1268. What does it tell us? It tells us, sabbatismos, a masculine noun, to keep the Sabbath, a keeping of a Sabbath, a rest as on the Sabbath. The passage links the idea of divine rest indissolubly with the Sabbath. End of quote. Did we see that, my dear people? So in other words, when the Bible says there remaineth therefore a rest, the Greek word is sabbatismos. It means there remaineth therefore a Sabbath keeping to the people of God. And then you ask yourself the question, which day is that Sabbath? We were told before, and God did rest the seventh day from all his works. Yes, my dear people. So we are clearly being told here that those who are believers keep the seventh day Sabbath. But what does the seventh day Sabbath mean? Why do we have to keep the seventh day Sabbath? What does the seventh day Sabbath mean for the people of God who believe? If we turn and we look at Ezekiel chapter 20, and we look at verse 12, here is what we are told. I quote, it says it, "Moreover, I gave them my Sabbath to be a sign between me and them, that they might know that I am Yahweh that sanctify them." End of quote. So in other words, keeping the Sabbath, therefore, is a fruit sign, a fruit of grace, because grace makes you keep the law. Grace makes you obey the truths of the Bible. So it is a fruit sign that God has sanctified you. And what sanctify means? It means separation from sin. Yes, my dear people. So, in all, keeping the seventh day Sabbath clearly means that God has separated you from sin. So from Seventh Day Adventists, the word seventh day points to the Sabbath, and the word Sabbath means that God has separated you from sin. Yes, my dear people, this is what it means. So then, therefore, seventh day, you keep the seventh day Sabbath, you have been separated, and is continually being separated from sin, away from sin. That's what it means. Now let's go to the word Adventist. Let's go to the word Adventist. And the word Adventist comes from the word Advent, and it means the coming of Christ. When you say Adventist, you mean the second coming of Jesus Christ. Yes, my dear people. Now, you see why it is a wonderful thing to have such a name, Seventh-day Adventist? You're talking about those who have the true God separating them from sin. They have a fruit sign of the true God that separates them from sin. And then they have the name Adventist, which shows that they are looking for the second visible appearing of Jesus Christ. Yes, my dear people. And what is this all about? What is this second visible appearing of Jesus Christ all about? First of all, in Acts chapter 1, verse 9 to verse 11, here is what we are told about this. I quote, it says this, "And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, Ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as you have seen him go into heaven." So we are actually being told here that just as you saw Christ going to heaven, you will see him return to the earth. Yes, my dear people. And this is what the word Adventist is all about. But it also means more. It means that you believe in a visible, global second coming of Christ where everybody will see his coming. Yes, my dear people. It is not like a secret coming, like the idea of the rapture, where nobody will know when he comes, but people will just suddenly disappear and go up to meet him. Or it isn't that he came in 1914. The fact of the matter is that this coming of Jesus Christ is clear, that all eyes shall see him. We quote from Revelation chapter 1, and we look at verse 7. Here is what it tells us. I quote, "Behold, he cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him, and they also which pierced him, and all the kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him. Even so, amen." So this clearly shows us a literal second coming of Jesus Christ. But what does the literal second coming of Jesus Christ mean? It means that when he's coming, we must prepare for his second coming. So his second coming must have us being prepared. And so We are looking for the second coming of Christ by preparing for his second coming. So much that the Bible clearly tells us that we must not be that evil servant that say the Lord is delayed his coming, but that we must look up for our redemption right now. If we look at 1 Thessalonians, and we look at 1 Thessalonians, and also at Hebrews chapter 9, we will see very clearly what the Bible tells us about the second coming of Christ. So let's first look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, and we would look at verse 12 and verse 13. Here is what we are told. Verse 12, it says this: "And the Lord make you increase and abound to love one in love one toward another and toward all men, even as we do toward you, to the end that he may establish your hearts unblameable in holiness before God and even our Father." So at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. So here, what do we see here? We see that we are actually to look for the second coming of Jesus Christ and to have our hearts be prepared, being unblameable. Yes, my dear people, this is what this scripture tells us here. But we must have love towards everyone. So as you're dealing with Adventists, Adventists means they are looking for the second coming of Christ. Therefore, they are having love one to another and getting their hearts unblameable. Yes, my dear people, that's exactly what it means. And then when we turn furthermore to Hebrews chapter 9 and we look at verse 28, it clearly tells us that when Jesus is coming, he's coming for a people free from sin, without sin. Again, Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 28, it says this: "So Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many, and unto them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin unto salvation." Now, it's not Christ that will be without sin, because he was always without sin from the beginning. So it is we that will be without sin unto salvation, experiencing salvation at the second coming of Christ. What does this mean? It means that the word Adventist means you're looking for the second coming of Jesus Christ and you're preparing for that second coming by sin freeness. Yes, my dear people. So then put it together. Seventh day, the Sabbath, the true God that separates us from sin. Adventist, looking for the literal, visible second coming of Jesus Christ in a preparatory way by being sin-free. What does it mean? That the name Seventh-day Adventist identifies a people who are supposed to be sin-free, literally sin-free, as they are looking for the second coming of Jesus Christ. Yes, my dear people. And furthermore, they are supposed to prepare and for and produce the 144,000. Yes, my dear people. Now, if that is the case with Seventh-day Adventists, why are we called Thuzia Seventh-day Adventists? We are called Thuzia Seventh-day Adventists because something happened with regards to the traditional Seventh-day Adventist church. That's why we exist as Seventh-day Adventists. You see, if a church no longer teaches their people that they can be sin-free, but that they must have sin, then they are not preparing for the second coming of Christ, because he's coming for sin-free people. But if that church tells you that you must have sin in your life, then they are not preparing for the second coming of Christ. They cannot produce the 144,000 who the Bible identifies as completely sin-free, with no guile in their mouth and without fault before God. So let's just look at some of the statements that is currently being taught by the traditional Seventh-day Adventist church with regards to sin-freeness. Now, what we are doing here, we are giving you literal quotations from some of their books. In this book, Between the Lion and the Lamb by Clifford Goldstein, in page 114, a book by the Seventh-day Adventist Church, here is what we are told. I quote: "Obviously, biblical perfection doesn't mean sinlessness. Biblical perfection must mean attitude, not actions." Could you imagine this is what people of a church are being told? That you are sinless in your attitude, but your actions are not sinless? So here is a person, they just went and stole somebody's fruits. And the person accused them and said, "Look at your actions." And they say, "Well, my attitude is sinless." Does it make sense? With this kind of teaching, you cannot produce a people to finish the last work. You cannot be true Seventh-day Adventist if you are in sin, because you are not yet the people of God when you are in sin. Again, here is this next quotation. George R. Knight, a professor in the Adventist Church, a historian, he teaches theological students, he trains ministers. Hear what he tells us. I quote in his book, I Used to Be Perfect, page 71. He says this: it is now time to turn to the Bible words used to express the English word perfection. None of them means sinlessness. Did you hear that? Again, on page 75 of his book, he says this: those in the second group are defined by John as being sinless, even though they still commit acts of sin for which they need to be forgiven. Then why does John call them sinless? So here the people is being trained that you can be having acts of sin and still be called sinless. You cannot produce sin-free people with this kind of teaching. Again, on page 78 of that very book, it says this: thus we can be perfect or sinless in attitude without being perfect or sinless in action. John, Paul, and Wesley agree on that point. Did you see it again? So here is a church that is teaching your attitude could be sinless, but your works could be sinful. Does it make sense? And these are the teachings, and these are the reasons why you cannot produce a people to finish God's work. Now, furthermore, this is the latest quarterly being taught in the traditional church. If you observe the picture outside, you will see Jesus is here covering the filthy robes of a person with his white robes. He didn't take away the filthy robes first and then cover the person with his pure, righteous robes, but he's covering the person's filthy robes with his white, pure robes here. This is this latest book. So what is this telling me? That my sins can be covered while those sins are on me with righteousness? However, when you go into the book does tell us that the dirty robes are removed. But what do they tell us are those robes? Remember what the Bible says: take away the filthy garments from him. And that is described as, I have caused thine iniquity to pass from thee. And then we are told, I have clothed thee with a change of raiment or clothes. So the person's filthy garments must be taken away, and then they must be clothed with a change of raiment. Now observe, I'm giving you a quotation here from this study book from the Adventist Church. I quote, it says this: Jesus strips away your old stained garments, your filthy rags, and wraps you in the robe of his perfect righteousness. Did you see that? So this statement in the book goes against the picture in the book. And this is the Adult Sabbath School Bible Study Guide, April, May, and June 2011, page 8. But then if you ask, what are those garments that have been removed? I quote page 76 of that same book. It says this: the old filthy ones are removed. According to the text, that means that the Lord has removed your iniquity from you. What it means is that the guilt and condemnation that belonged to him had been taken away. End of quote. Did you see that? So we are actually being told what is removed is your guilt and condemnation. They didn't say your sins, but we are told here, let his iniquity pass from him. Now, the guilt is a result of your sins. The condemnation is a result of your iniquities. So then, therefore, if you remove the guilt and the condemnation as the robes, the filthy robes, the sins still remain. Hence, therefore, this shows what they're saying. Now, this is the reason why you cannot be a true Seventh-day Adventist while teaching that sin remains in your life. Now, let's just quickly get to the word tools here. The word tools here. If we turn to Psalms 50 and we look at verses 2 to 6, here is what the word tousia, where the word tousia is identified in the Septuagint, the Greek version of the Old Testament. I quote, it says this: out of Zion, which is the church, the perfection of beauty, God had shined. So here the perfection of beauty, God shines in the church. This is the church being sin-free. It goes on: our God shall come and shall not keep silent. So this is the context of this is at the time of the coming of Christ. It goes on: our God shall come and shall not keep silent. A fire shall devour before him, and it shall be very tempestuous round about him. He shall call to the heavens above and to the earth, that he may judge his people. So here the judgment is going on at the time Christ is about to come. Then it says this, gather my saints together unto me, those that have made my covenant with me by sacrifice to Zeal. So here the word sacrifice to Zeal is there. So those who have made God's covenant with them by sacrifice is tousia. And the actual word tousian literally is in the Greek New Testament. What does that mean? You give up all selfishness for the sake of love to God and love to your fellow men. That's what the word tousia or tousia means. Now, let's look at Romans chapter 12 and we look at verse 1. Here is what we are told. I quote, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. The word is tousian. A living sacrifice, tousian, holy and acceptable unto God, which is a reasonable service. So what do we have here? We have clearly that tousia identifies those who have given up all selfishness and they're completely given over to God based on the sacrifice of Christ. So here you have tousia Seventh-day Adventist. A Seventh-day Adventist, and let me just put it this way for you. Let me just read it this way for you as I have written here. Tousia Seventh-day Adventist is a person who has given up self and selfishness through the sacrifice of Christ for the sake of love to God and love to humanity. He shows the seventh day as the Sabbath, which is the sign that the true God Yahweh has separated him from sin. And in this state, he looks for the visible second coming of Jesus Christ. That's what a Tousian Seventh-day Adventist is. And finally, why do we have the name Escape for Thy Life? Escape for Thy Life is a phrase that is taken from Genesis chapter 19, which was told to Lot. And I just want to read here for you a quotation from the books Patriots and Prophets by Ellen G. White, a special messenger and prophetess in Seventh-day Adventism. Here is what she says about the name Escape for Thy Life. I quote, the daily record of passing events testifies to the fulfillment of his words. The world is fast becoming ripe for destruction. Soon, the judgments of God are to be poured out, and sin and sinners are to be consumed. Before the destruction of Sodom, God sent a message to Lot, escape for thy life. The same voice of warning was heard by the disciples of Christ before the destruction of Jerusalem. There was a coming out, a decided separation from the wicked, an escape for life. So it was in the days of Noah, so with Lot, so with the disciples prior to the destruction of Jerusalem. And so it will be in the last days. Again, the voice of God is heard in a message of warning, bidding his people separate themselves from prevailing iniquity. Like the dwellers on the veil of Sodom, the people are dreaming of prosperity and peace. Escape for thy life is the warning from the angels of God. And so, my dear people, in closing off, this is the reason why we are called Tuesday Seventh-day Adventists, and this is the reason why the name Escape for Thy Life is used. And we hope that you have learned these facts, and we're going to show you many beautiful things, many interesting things, and many spiritual things on this television program. So may God bless you until we meet again in our next program. In Jesus' holy name, amen.